Hi, welcome to the Signal Pad. In this episode, there's a couple of things that I want to discuss. I also want to announce the winner of the Rod & Shorts Oscilloscope giveaway. The way I chose the winner was I took all the comments that you left on the video, and I took the list of all my Patreon supporters and combined them, and I took one number, and then one random person came out of the list, and that person is Samuel Edmonds. So, Samuel, if you're watching this video, leave us a message, let us know how you feel about winning the scope. And I also hope that you would use this scope not just for your own benefit, but also to somehow give back to the community. I know you're a student, perhaps your classmates, university can benefit from it, or you could even make videos or blog posts to help others benefit from the fact that you've won this scope. Now, this process was also really heartbreaking for me. There was almost 1,000 people that wanted this scope, and I could only give away one. I genuinely wish I had the financial ability to buy hundreds of scopes and give them away to everybody. This goes back to the discussion I had with Dave while I was in Australia. I really do not understand the ability of some people to own hundreds of millions of dollars of things and be content with that. I don't want to make myself seem like I'm an extraordinary generous person. There are far more generous and good people in this world than I. But I really do not understand how those people can be comfortable with such a vast amount of wealth accumulation. And I hope that I never descend into such disregard from my other fellow human beings. Now, the second thing I wanted to discuss has to do with a question I always get, and it is about the repairing of equipment and where I get my equipment and how to repair them. I get a lot of emails about a whole bunch of different topics as well, and I'm sorry if I don't get back to you. There's just simply not enough time in the day. Now, about broken equipment, I get most of it from eBay, as to be expected. Now, the price of broken equipment on eBay has gone up significantly in the past couple of years. This is partly due to my videos and the videos of other people on blog posts and so on, which help repair these instruments. So naturally, more people are inclined to buy broken equipment as a result. And of course, this means that you're going to have to keep trying on eBay until you find what you're looking for. Also, keep in mind that RF instruments often require other RF instruments for repair, or at least for calibration. So don't start from those if this is the first thing you're going to try. Get things that are a little bit more familiar, perhaps a laboratory power supply or a simple function generator would be something that's nice to start with. And always check the internet to make sure there is some level of documentation, schematic, or service manual available, because reverse engineering is just a nightmare. Now, I've done a lot of that on my channel, especially with RF equipment, and it does take a long time. And you need a certain level of expertise, of course, to do this. And that's the whole point. That's what you're trying to learn. So keep these things in mind when you do that. And I've also bought equipment from eBay that I just simply couldn't repair. Just recently, I bought a Fluke 434, and it looked good on the outside, and the only symptom was that it wasn't powering on. But when I got it and I opened it, it was completely rusted inside. Luckily, this was sold by some instrument recycling company on eBay, and they accepted the return, and I sent the unit back. But this may not have been the case, and you would have lost your money, and it was about $700, which is not insignificant. So keep in mind that when you want to do this. And also, just look around for other used equipment which are not broken. I mean, it's amazing that the cost of instrumentation has come down so much also recently. You can buy oscilloscopes and power supplies and function generators from Regal or Siglent, for example, which are really, really low cost, and they perform quite well. I've reviewed a couple of them here on my channel. So keep that in mind for your next purchase. It doesn't always have to be a broken instrument. It's just the RF equipment that's quite expensive. So start with something else. I also just finished teaching a course at Columbia University. This was the second time I've taught there. And the course was about RF microwave measurements and techniques. And it was really amazing how the students responded to this course. First of all, they really liked it, and we had a lot of interesting discussions. And I showed them block diagrams of how instruments work on the inside, talked about measurement techniques, the theory, and the practice. And there's so much subtlety in measurement. And until you get your hand on something, you can't appreciate the subtleties there. We just talked about, the first lecture was about just power supply measurements, very basic stuff. And the number of things that can go wrong with just a power supply measurement was really quite staggering. So keep that in mind. I wish I could share with you the videos of those lectures, but unfortunately they weren't recorded, but the students seem to really like them. So if I get an opportunity to do more of that type of style of lecture here on my channel, I think I will do that. I think it would be beneficial for everybody. So the next topic is about Patreon. As you know, Patreon recently had some changes in the way payments are calculated, and this caused a huge problem for them. And a lot of people pulled out of Patreon as a result of that. I myself, for example, lost a whole bunch of supporters as a result while this transition was being made, and eventually Patreon recognized their error and reverted back. And I supported all the people who canceled their Patreon. Now, this is why they changed their mind, is because of what you guys did. Now, not all of the people who canceled actually came back, but maybe they will come back in the future. Now, everything you give to Patreon on my channel goes back to the lab. And the idea is that I would use those funds to purchase equipment for repair or to buy microwave components and so on for more experiments in the future. And that's the whole point. And there are levels and goals that I have set up on my channel for that purpose. Just keep in mind that if supporting my channel means that you would not be able to support a charity or someone else, then by all means, do not support this channel. The idea is not to put a burden on your shoulder. Support here if you can, or if it means that you're not doing something for yourself so that you can support the channel, again, do the thing that you need to do for yourself. This channel is supported primarily by the people who are able to support and who want to give back to the community without suffering huge consequences. And this is what I wanted. I wanted to put that money back into the channel and rest assured that every penny that comes in here is used exactly for that purpose. Now, I also want to provide some kind of a reward system for the people who are on Patreon. So this is my quest to ask you guys, and what do you think should be done? What kind of goals should I give? What kind of rewards should I have? How do I give back to the Patreon supporters who are giving on the channel? Some ideas could be ask them for what kind of videos they want and make dedicated videos for that, or whatever else that comes onto your mind. Just leave a comment and let me know. And if you're not supporting me on the Patreon channel, at least go and take a look and see what you find and see what kind of goals I have set up and see what other people have to say and what kind of videos I post there. Not every video that I make actually ends up on Patreon. Only a fraction of them I charge to the Patreon account. All the other ones are just simply shared with everybody. And all the videos are public. There's nothing that is hidden in Patreon or anything like that. Everybody is benefiting from the videos. That's the whole point. The point is to give back to the community. So Dave from EEV Blog just recently said that he would accept videos from other channels on his channel during the break in order to provide them with some exposure to all of his subscribers. I found this to be an extraordinary generous move, and I applaud him for that, because it would allow some of the smaller channels to gain more subscribers, because all of the other people who watch them, and if you like the channel, then they would go, of course, and subscribe to it. Now, subscriptions is a strange thing, because it's in a positive feedback. The higher your subscription, the more people will eventually watch the video and your videos show up on other channels, which then gain you, of course, more subscribers. Now, some people have the ability to just gain these subscriptions. For example, Mehdi from Lecture Boom, he's just such a funny man and his videos are so entertaining to watch. And now he has over 1 million subscribers, even much more than Dave. This is really quite amazing. But every channel formula is different. So my channel's videos are highly technical. They're often quite long, up to an hour, even 2 hours sometimes. And this, by definition, filters the number of people who would find the channel interesting. And more advanced topics, of course, have fewer people who would watch them. So it's very difficult for a channel like mine, for example, to have a lot of subscribers, and nor is it intended to. You're not going to have 1 million people watching advanced RF microwave videos. It's just not going to happen. But it's really great to see that Dave is going to use this opportunity to give exposure to some of the smaller channels, especially the channels that have less than 1,000 subscribers. I think they would really benefit from this. So good on you, Dave. I'm really impressed by this move. And the last thing I want to talk about has nothing to do with this channel. Now, normally, I almost never talk about politics or things outside of electronics at all. But a couple of things that have happened that I really feel like I must say something. Aside from the fall of the net neutrality, which is a disaster in itself, the CDC was recently prohibited from using 7 words in their reports. And those words were diversity, fetus, transgender, vulnerable, entitlement, science-based, and evidence-based. They actually want the CDC not to say things like science-based and evidence-based. This is an intellectual emergency for this country. Forget about these 7 words specifically. Any words, banning any words in any context, is really quite scary. Now, you don't even have to use George Orwell's 1984 as an example. There are countries in the world today where thoughts and freedoms and speech is prohibited. I came from one of those countries, and to see the regression of some of the ideas that govern this country into that is really quite scary for me. I love this place, and that's why I'm here. That's why I'm trying to contribute to this country. But seeing this is really scary, because I know what it's like to not have it, and all it takes is one generation to fall into this trap, to forget what it means to be able to do these things. So instead of using things like evidence-based, they want to say CDC bases its recommendations on science in consideration with community standards and wishes. Well, a healthy community's standards and wishes should be evidence-based and science-based. Would you want your surgeon to perform things that are in considerations with the community wishes? Would you want your pilot to do that? Shouldn't we all strive for that? Shouldn't we all strive for a country, a system, where evidence and science is the deciding factor on how we choose between policies? This is really dangerous, and it's very, very difficult to watch, especially for someone who has no control over it. So the only thing I'm saying is voice your concern. I know that the people who are watching this video, 99.9% of them are going to be in agreement with each other. So what we have to do is we have to speak about it. We have to let people know how unusual this is. And this is not normal. This is not what a successful democracy should do. And I'm sure people at the CDC are already very upset about this. So that's the only thing we can do is to try and fight this together and to spread the news of how dangerous such a thing can be. And there you have it. I hope that these discussions were helpful, and I appreciate that you listened to me. And go ahead and leave a comment. Let me know what you think. Go to the Patreon page. Let me know how you want the reward systems to be set up and the goals to be set up. I think this will be beneficial for everybody. And I'm working on some repair. There's one right here next to me that's kind of half open right now. So I hope to finish these things soon. And I'll see you in the comment section.